oh, nice to be taken out of the sleeve. It was getting a bit hot in there. If you're listening to this online, that joke isn't for you. The joke for you is...
Hello, and you're very welcome to the second of our B-side casts.
I'm Pete, as in repeating ideas. This is Evan, as in eventually we'll do something new. Ross, as in I finished the down column, now moving over to the clues in the across section.
Hi.
Sam, as in let's all sing a Sam. And Bex, as in David Beckham. Welcome to the other side of the 12-inch vinyl that you've opened. Having just heard the new single and the old single, you've now come to us for a dissection of the former. For a dissection of the latter, consult the prior cassette. For a dissection in general... consult your GP. Before we get stuck into the groove, I want to start by saying that it's really fun to be speaking to you via a medium that makes no fucking sense.
Not one bit.
Wherever you are right now, I want you to look at the spinning piece of plastic that's on your turntable. How is what I'm saying now coming from a piece of hard thing in your room? Like, I know I get it, a bit of steel runs across a groove and makes a noise.
I don't get it.
Yeah, still, why?
I could run a knitting needle over some Tupperware, it's not going to play La Bamba.
You go, oh yeah, because it's all electric speakers and stuff. But if you just play it with no speakers, it's still, you can still hear it.
Yeah.
The only explanation is that a piece of vinyl contains every sound ever recorded, and when it's being pressed, it just cuts down to where the sound that you made. That's it. That's all it can be, right? Yeah. Either that or magic.
It is. I do actually know how vinyl works.
To me, like, vinyl makes less sense than, like, CD.
Basically, the little needle vibrates. You know, you were
Sam, this podcast is not for nerds, okay?
Stop that.
Onto the track that went from jingle to single. Long-term listeners of the podcast Higher Fidelity will recognize the song they just heard on the A side of this as the theme of our show, Higher Fidelity. As far as I can remember, this song was part of the first sort of batch it brought to the band when we discussed a bit starting a new band.
Definitely.
I remember, Ross, you pegged it really early on.
Yes.
And I had to ask you to stop. I mean, yeah, the recording process was kind of very similar to Don't Say a Word.
Yeah.
Three of us went in, did the basic backing track, bass and drums and vocals in Deep End. I think the biggest difference is that we doubled the personnel involved in terms of we had Bex and Sam come in on to advise and harmonies and hand claps, and we had the producer's daughter, Mia. Damien. The producer's daughter, Damien. We had Damien, the producer's daughter. We had... Damien.
Comma.
Damien got in his daughter, Mia, to help with the hand claps, and her friend Jo came in and helped out as well, and we're going to speak to them in a bit later on. But we have Bex and Sam, as they say, here. How was it getting to finally record in Deep End?
I thoroughly enjoyed my experience, even though it did get tense.
Well, that's because, to be fair, we had like 4 hours left to do all the harmonies and all the Moog stuff.
Exactly. No, it wasn't actually tense. It was just like, are we going to pull this off? Yeah, no, I had a great time. It was really nice. I've never actually recorded in a proper studio before that.
Brilliant. Sam, what about yourself getting the chance to go in and see a lot of amazing gear? I think you saw the John Lennon mic.
Of course. Well, I mean, I stood next to it. I sang into it. It's a great studio because it's just full of so much cool stuff that I've always wanted to see. And it's, you know, full of great people. Things did get tense, one could say, but I mean, can't have great art without a bit of frustration in the middle.
I think it was just, moral of the story was, listen to me, because the whole tense situation would have been gone if you just listened to me in the first place.
Fair, we'll take that. The biggest difference in this track and Don't Say a Word is the blatant overuse, misuse and abuse of the Moog synthesizer and
Indeed.
Vox Continental that were repaired in time for the session.
Mini Moog and major Vox Continental.
How do you feel getting, like, actually twiddling knobs and then actually get to use the stuff? As
yeah,
well?
Absolutely. Fantastically brilliant. Played Vox Continentals on our studio recordings in the past. But it had been years. Hadn't ever properly programmed, I suppose you'd call it, a mini Moog.
They call it programmed.
I'd never twiddled a Moog. So yeah, building sounds on the Moog, like, you know, getting your fucking tone signal and creating the sound that you were going to use in the recording was really cool. Very exciting.
There's a bit of confusion about the lyrics that started on day one and continued right up until we were doing that very last harmony as to whether it's endure or enjoy. It'll surely become legend.
Yes. It was the third option knocking around.
I thought Adore was knocking around as well.
Adore, yeah.
Well, Pete, the reason that this happened was because you sent me the lyrics and it said Adore. But then we were obviously rehearsing and I was hearing the N sound coming from Ross because he was saying enjoy. So I put those two together and it sounded like endure.
You created something that absolutely ruined the narrative.
Yes.
But yeah. Even when we first started practicing from the demos, the lyrics said Adore, but I was listening to the demo and it said endure, or it was saying enjoy, but I just, yeah, same thing as Bex, put them two together, said endure, and you said to me, that makes no sense. It's Enjoy. And I was like, what? There's how many fucking versions is there of this?
All I'll say is grammar don't matter when you're in a flow.
Definitely another lyric that I had wrong.
Well, there was, is it I Want Your Extended Edition or I'll Watch Your Extended Edition was also debated.
Would it say I Want Your Extended Edition? Like, it's like, I'll Watch Your Extended Edition. Sounds a bit more voyeuristic than I Want.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, but I do think an Endure definitely slipped into the mix.
Probably. Yeah.
Definitely in every live performance, I said Endure.
Brilliant. Well, that's good to know. As I said, we're not going to go too deep into the lyrics as to do, so it would be horrendous for me and for the listeners. But the only thing I will point out is that I have, unlike the character in the first verse of the song, I have never seen an Eric Rohmer or a Steven Soderbergh film. They just happen to fit the meter. But we did hit pay dirt, as when I was Googling how to spell the names, I found that they're actually held in quite high regard. So we can just thank our lucky stardom that, like, Michael Bay and Lucifer Valentine didn't fit the meter. The original version of the song that I sent on had a very different riff. Now, oftentimes a riff changes from inception to conception to production to releasion due to its like sonic properties or like a reappraisal of how it works with other parts and things like that. The reason the riff was changed in this instance was due to a lack of range in the singer's voice and a lack of transposing ability in the guitarist's head. We had changed the key and we're like, I can't play the riff in the new key. I don't know how to do it. Capo was useless, as it normally is.
That's another thing that doesn't make sense. Like, vinyl, capos. How's that work?
Now, the actual demo itself. This was demoed about three times, I think, wasn't it?
About that.
It's all you, isn't it?
There is one where it's all me, and then there's one where the demo that we're probably going to play, I'm on everything except the lead guitar, which is you.
All right.
Then, obviously, my voice is not present.
Rightly so.
Yeah.
Because remember, there was a few different versions. We came back, and you were like, oh, I've reworked it. Put in the riff in the pre-chorus. You'd written a load of extra bits for it.
Threw a minor chord in there, an A minor.
Oh, you did in the intro. I forgot you changed the intro, actually. Yeah, I forgot you changed the intro. Actually, I did. I forgot you changed the intro.
Yeah, because I think we'd been struggling to get it, and there was a couple of abandoned demo attempts.
Because the song was there at its core, first of all. Yeah. Let's just establish that.
That was never in any question. But we were struggling to nail a treatment of it, and then one night I just went, I'm just going to pull this apart alone in the room, put it back together again, and then we collaborated from there. Respect the nuanced work of Rohmer and his impact on filmmaking. But we see through Soderbergh and his over-reliance on color saturation. I keep a history of film in my bottom drawer. Well, I'm a Philistine who's terrified of your cutting room.
Now we're going to kick into, I can't believe kick into follows me across every fucking format. We're going to do a segment from the actual show itself as a little trailer of what you can expect on the show when you are on. This is Sonic Seconds. Yes, this is Sonic Seconds, where we play 2 or 3 seconds from a song that just makes the track for us. But this time, it's specifically about the song High Fidelity. So my Sonic Seconds is the triple harmony going into the second chorus. Initially, it was very ambitious, first of all. It was going to be a 4-part stacked quadrupled harmony leading into the last chorus. Had we pulled it off, it would have been transcendent. But it wasn't working in the rehearsal room. We said, that's a studio idea. We got to the studio trying to be the Hollies.
We couldn't do it.
Couldn't fucking happen. It was the root of the aforementioned fucking tension. Aforementioned tension is a good name for an album.
Yeah.
Mm.
I guess we got that sorted.
Done.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we tried that for about an hour or so. It was a debate between, like, do we do it falsetto or do it full-throated? I think I went and did a falsetto one and I heard laughing in the cans. And then I did a full bellowed one and I heard heavier laughing in the cans. Then the idea was abandoned after everyone got thick about it. Ross Ferdinand did come in and say, let's just fucking scale it back and do it at 3-part and end up coming out sounding great.
I do like that bit too.
Do we know the order of who is the harmony?
I think it's Ross, you, Becky, and then Ross on top.
Yeah, a Becky sandwich with Pete and Sam garnish and Ross rye.
Yeah.
Jesus.
And then
Christ.
An Evan side salad that was sent back. Sorry, that was really mean.
It was, yeah. What can I say? I'm the plate because I'm drumming on it.
So Ross, quickly, your sonic seconds.
Since you rudely take mine, I'll go with the middle eight. Your reaction, the last your reaction on the demo, it was actually better because I had a little voice crack that you can't really fake, but it sounded really nice. So I tried to do it again. It didn't quite work, but I still liked that bit.
Mine is guitar lick that was arrived at through much noodling. So we were trying to figure out a way of spicing up the second verse, the held C chord, with a bit of a guitar lick that wasn't going to be just conventional, like Chuck Berry style. How do we make it a bit more angular and difficult sounding? We kept trying loads of different approaches and different ways we could do it. And then
Damien mentioned, why don't we do it? Why don't we use the Dorian scale?
And we went, what's that?
Him and the engineer Frank spent a while figuring out what were the notes of the Dorian scale for C.
Obviously, the da-na-na-na is cool, but something really nicely coalesces on the ba-ba-ba-na.
Very good. Bex, what's your sonic second?
Well, both of mine were taken. I think the da-na-na-na-na-na-na sounds really, really cool. I think it sounds really great. I think the way that it has translated onto the final recording sounds really brilliant.
Sam, what's your sonic second?
In the middle eighth where Ev plays the Moog synthesizer, hearing that from the rec room was really exciting. I'd never heard that in the song before either, obviously, because we've been playing it live. There's no keyboards or anything. So hearing that in the studio was very, very nice, and it sounds great in the track too. Sonic
seconds. Brilliant. Okay, great. And now we move on to a very important bit as well. How this single, this 12-inch single, looked. Cover art done expertly by Sam Garrity once again, knocking it out of the park with a fantastic design. The initial idea, you got in touch with me and said, I want to do dry transfers. And much like the way a Dorian scale was an entirely new concept for me, the idea of dry transfers, letterset dry transfers existing was mental to me. What's really cool about the cover, I think, is that it was all made on like a tabletop, you know, by hand.
Exactly, yeah. Well, I think, you know, even with the last single, I wanted to do something that kind of evoked the imagery should match up with the music, which obviously is sort of new wave. To me, it's sort of new wave. So I wanted to make some artwork that represented that. And I think for this one, I wanted to up that. I think even at the time of D-Saw's release, I said to you, for the next release, I want to go even more physical when I'm making it. Yeah, as Pete said, I did it all on a tabletop. I wanted to stay away from computers. Just, it was nice actually having the opportunity to stick those letters down and arrange it all physically. And I enjoyed the collaborative process of, you know, sending off little sketches to everyone and getting everyone's feedback.
And yeah, a top job from Surf Blue Studios.
Thank you very much.
Now, the genesis of the podcast and its discussion topics come from the novel High Fidelity by Nick Hornby. No secret to anybody. While we're backing the song High Fidelity with our own podcast, Higher Fidelity, it seems as good a time as any to really roll into the theme and do some of the lists that the characters come up with in the story that made the novel famous and its fans insufferable. We're going to go for your top five track one, side ones, and mine are Twin Cinema, New Pornographer, Standing on My Own Again by Graham Coxon, She Does It Right by Dr. Feelgood, Happy Hour by the House Martins, and then Run 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 by The Who.
Nice.
Welcome to the Working Week, Elvis Costello, Bigger Stones, The Beat Farmers, Happy Hour, House Martins, Radiation Vibe, Fountains of Wayne, and Shake Some Action, Flaming Groovies.
Yeah, Happy Hour was in my runners-up as well, so we all went for the Happy Hour thing. Mine are Absolutely Sweet Marie, Jason and the Scorchers, Do Just What You Want, Lou Lewis, Rough Kids, Kilburn and the High Roads, Hello Susie, The Move, and One Step Beyond, Madness.
Very, very good. Okay, Sam, hit us with yours.
So Happy Hour by the House Martins. No, I'm joking. Yeah, so in chronological order of release, Blue Rondo a la Turk by the Dave Brubeck Quartet.
Nice.
No.
Wouldn't It Be Nice by the Beach Boys. Care of Cell 44, The Zombies. Do It Again, Steely Dan. And Vinegar Heart by Ton Bruquet.
Bex, what's your top five?
So you've all gone for classics. Mine was more of a, I'm just going to go through my Spotify and find what I can find. Johnny Don't Do It, 10cc. Lazy Days, Flying Burrito Brothers. Love for Tender, Elvis Costello and the Attractions. Radios in Motion, XTC. And The Great Big No by the Lemonheads.
Next list, top five books.
Yes.
Mine are in descending order. We've got Mostly Harmless by Douglas Adams. So Long and Thanks for All the Fish by Douglas Adams. Life, the Universe and Everything by Douglas Adams. The Restaurant at the End of the Universe by Douglas Adams. And finally, High Fidelity by Nick Hornby.
Nice.
Well, my top five are, because they're only books I've ever read, are The Game of Thrones.
Brilliant. Okay, great. Any particular order?
No, in no order.
Okay.
Not really.
Yeah, top five books in descending order. Number five, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
So your list starts where mine should have ended.
Yeah, genuinely. Number four, Childhood, Wind in the Willows. Number three, Funny, Groucho Marx's autobiography, Groucho and Me. Number two, Informative, The Beatles Tune In by Mark Lewisohn. And finally, the single greatest book inarguably ever written, the most geniusly brilliant thing of all time, I Partridge, We Need to talk about Alan. By Alan Partridge, with help from Steve Coogan, Armando Iannucci, Neil Gibbons and Rob Gibbons.
In no order, Talented Mr. Ripley by Patricia Highsmith, Stasiland by Anna Funder, Day of the Triffids by John Wyndham, Red Dwarf Infinity Welcomes Careful Drivers by Rob Grant and Doug Naylor, and Iowati on Top by Richard Iowati.
Becky, what are your top five books?
My top five books don't exist yet. Goodnight Mr. Tom, Safe Harbor, Kintsugi's Kingdom, The Fault in Our Stars, and Johnny Marr's autobiography, Set the Boy Free.
That'll do. Last list for this time. Top five songs with no solo. A minor, Andrew and Drag by The Magnetic Fields. Milkman of Human Kindness by Billy Bragg. Waiting by The Rentals. Ghost of a Chance by The Blades. And Up the Junction by Squeeze, which is the best song that doesn't actually have anything except verses in it.
That's a very good list. Mine are Angels Wanna Wear My Red Shoes, Elvis Costello. Is She Really Going Out With Him, Joe Jackson. Build Me Up, Buttercup by The Foundations. Crash by The Primitives. Bonzo Goes to Bitburg by The Ramones.
That's an incredible list. I really like
that. Yeah, that was really good.
Yeah, I went for You Can't Catch Me by Chuck Berry. Fire Brigade by The Move. I Want to Tell You by The Beatles. Heart of the City, the original single B-side version,
yes,
by Nick Lowe.
And a very important distinction.
And Land of Hope and Glory by Madness.
So we've got I Only Have Eyes for You by The Flamingos. Daydream by Wallace Collection. Surf's Up, Beach Boys. Ogden's Nut Gone Flake, The Small Faces. And Autumn Almanac by The Kinks.
Bex, what about you?
52 Girls by The B-52s. Wave of Mutilation by The Pixies. So Sad About Us, The Who.
Oh, good one.
What Am I Doing Hanging Round by The Monkees.
Jesus. You... fuck's sake.
That's the song I was
fucking
trying to
think. Hell, yeah. Becky.
And Tell Me Why by The Beatles.
That's a very good list.
Right.
I'm also so scared that any of those songs actually do have a solo and I've forgotten.
Yeah, me too.
Oh, I know.
And now our first guest we're going to fly in via the phone is Damien, our producer, his daughter Mia and her friend Joe, who also helps out, and his son Levi, who I don't think is going to appear on the call.
Please leave a message for the person you're calling after the tone.
Hi, Damien. I'm trying to ring you about the thing I told you about. No worries, get back to me when you can. Right. Damien?
Hello, Pete.
Hello, Damien. How are you getting on?
I'm good.
Have you got the stars there?
I have indeed.
Hello, folks. Evan Ross are here as well. They said
hello.
They said hello.
Folks. How are you?
Mia and Joe, how's it getting on? You gave us a hand with the hand claps, didn't you?
We did, yeah. What's the crack?
Devil a head, Joe. Good to hear from you. Keep them well.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Okay, so how did it feel to actually get the chance to record in a proper studio? How did you feel going down into the live room and giving us a hand?
It was good crack.
Yeah, it was faster, actually. It's kind of different to what I thought it would be like.
Presumably, you've never been in a studio before.
Well, I have.
It's your house, Mia.
Yes, exactly.
The part you contribute to, the hand claps, make up my favourite bit of the song, which is the entire second verse where the hand claps and the organ play off each other. We really appreciate you doing it and would love to have you back on again if you were up for it.
Yeah, that'd be class.
That'd be great.
Joe, Mia, pleasure having you on and we'll chat to you again.
See ya, bye-bye.
Bye.
That was lovely.
And now we're going to roll into our second guest, who probably isn't very lovely. We're very excited to have on the show Paul McClune, our John Peel, everyone's John Peel, the man who made our debut single What It Was. Well, we made it What It Was, but he made it the success that it was.
What it was in the beginning is now and ever shall be.
It's Paul McClune, Today FM's resident late-night tastemaker. Now, Paul, pleasure for you to be on with us. Delighted to have you here.
Oh, my God. Well, I can't possibly live up to that introduction, but thank you very much. It's lovely to be with you.
Now, we're getting very close to the end groove, so quickly as you can, what's your top five track one side ones of all time?
Okay, I'm going to do this vaguely chronologically. I'm going to start off with Hard Day's Night, Beatles, that chord. They're still trying to figure out what the hell's going on with that chord.
Okay, and what's your next one?
I'm going to go with something from my youth when I was kind of 13. Well, I wasn't kind of 13. I was actually just historically 13. And the first LP that I owned was by Adam and the Ants. And it was the second album by that band called Kings of the Wild Frontier. That album kicks off with a song called Dog Eat Dog. Again, a single. They were copying the Burundi drummers of Africa. Adam and the Ants just stole it, basically, and put it on pop records, which itself was kind of a genius move. I just love the way it fades up. And then on top of it, they're doing all this kind of whooping and howling and kind of tribal chanting.
Brilliant. Okay, what's your next track as well?
Okay, The Smiths, 1985. An album came out literally on my 18th birthday. Giving away my age, but there you go. The album Meat Is Murder, which was the second studio album by The Smiths. Excuse me, I just got to take a quick sip of tea. Otherwise, my cotton mouth will completely ruin your podcast.
I think your opinions are ruining the podcast anyway, but don't worry.
Well, that's true. When Meat Is Murder kicks in with a song called Headmaster Ritual, it doesn't mess around. It just kicks right in. There's a kind of a drum roll with the guitars at the same time. No messing, no build up, nothing. Just boom, straight in. I actually played it I started the show with it, actually, on last night's show, just because I was thinking about this.
Oh, brilliant. Okay, and your fourth track, what are we up to now? Your penultimate one.
Penultimately, funnily enough, another track that I played on the show with this in mind, My Bloody Valentine, Loveless.
Brilliant.
Again, a second album. Only Shallow is the song, and everything comes in at once. The track, it just goes huge. It's almost like the Big Bang. There's nothing, and then there's just everything. And it's wholly different to anything else you will have heard before it, or arguably since.
And your final top five track one, Cybern, of all time, what have you got for us?
Well, Pete, I have to give the last word to Mr. Bowie, because Station to Station.
Excellent.
Station to Station, right? Oh, God, what a way to start an album. Don't even know what it is for, like, the first minute and a half. It's just this whirring synthesizer basically doing a train noise, and piece by piece the track comes in, almost like they're making their appearance one at a time, you know, almost like walking onto the stage one at a time. You don't know where you're going, and you're not getting there really all that quickly. It just builds and builds and builds until Bowie eventually comes in with that incredible line, "The Return of the Thin White Duke." There's no other way to describe that. It's just sheer complete genius, and it's happening in front of your very ears. He's on the edge in so many ways, but crucially, also musically, he is absolutely the cutting edge of pop music at that time in the mid-70s. There's no competition.
I saw a review there, someone dug up an old review of Station to Station at the time, and the pull quote was, "Bowie's at his worst when he's this boring," which I think is almost entirely at odds with what you've said there.
Yeah, well, what did they know?
Look, Paul, and one more list for you here. What are your top five new singles that you're going to play quite a lot once they're finally out?
Oh, well, definitely the Zen Arcade new single. I might do That Was Then, This Is Now with Don't Say a Word.
You know exactly what to say. You know exactly what to say, Paul. This has been your time on our B-side, and we really appreciate you coming on and look forward to hearing you play it an absolute gargantuan amount. You can play the B-side as well if you want. You can play this and save yourself the hassle of having to present a show.
How meta would that be?
Brilliant. Look, Paul, we'll let you get on, and we really appreciate you being on, all right?
Cheers, man. Thanks.
Thanks for
being here. Bye bye.
Cheers, lad.
Bye.
How far away from the end groove are we?
It's getting tight going.
Well, I'm Pete.
I'm Ross.
I'm Evan.
I'm Sam.
I'm Becky.
We have been the band Zen Arcade, and it's been a pleasure speaking to you from this impossible device.